When it comes to creating something dark, bizarre, and disturbing, it's only fitting that someone whose entire career has essentially been one big homage to the world of horror has the opportunity to create one big love letter to the genre of horror in a full-on balls-to-the-walls horror flick. Well, that's what Rob Zombie did, and what he still continues to do. One brief look at Rob Zombie's discography and self-directed music videos is all you really need in order to understand this man has a passion for the world of horror. And while over the years he's gone on to create and remake a handful of horror movies, the movie we'll be taking a look at today, House of a Thousand Corpses, was his first feature-length film. A movie which, at the time of release, came incredibly close to not being shown to anyone. Originally purchased and funded by Universal Studios, upon completion, the movie would be shelved by the studio due to fears of it receiving an NC-17 rating, a rating which can often be viewed as a death sentence for movies. Luckily, Rob was able to repurchase the rights to his movie and sell them onto Lionsgate, where it would then receive a theatrical release a handful of years after its original creation. So when you hear the backstory behind this movie, it makes you wonder, what could it possibly contain which stopped it dead in its tracks? Well, while certainly not a family-friendly film, containing its fair share of disturbing content and themes, but compared to what we've covered on this channel in the past, it really makes you wonder what the climate must have been like for over-the-top horror movies in the early 2000s. The movie begins with us getting a glimpse into this strange and twisted world with a TV advertisement for Captain Spaulding's amusement park, gas station, and fried chicken business all rolled into one. We see Spaulding sporting his signature clown makeup in his place of business, when all of a sudden, two guys kick in the front door in an ill-fated attempt to hold the place up. Spaulding, being the crazy clown that he isn't fazed in the slightest by having a gun pointed directly at his head. After a tense standoff with the men, and Spaulding making it incredibly clear that he isn't going to be giving them what they want, another person barges through the door, but this person cracks one of the would-be robbers over the head, giving Spaulding the chance to pull out his gun and paint the walls with the other's brain matter. And that's our introduction to the mindset of many of the characters within this film. They'll laugh directly into the face of death, and certainly not hesitate to send another living being to the afterlife. In fact, they'll quite enjoy doing that. We then get introduced to our four protagonists of the movie. In any other movie, you'd be safe to say that these four will be the main characters of the story, but not in House of a Thousand Corpses. As we'll soon discover, the real main characters are far more interesting, violent, and disturbed than these supposed teenagers, played by people clearly too old to be teenagers. Them being Bill, Jerry, Denise, and Mary. It's Halloween Eve, and they're all on their way to visit Denise's father for the holiday. But in typical horror movie fashion, they're running low on gas, so they decide to pull into Spaulding's bizarre mishmash of different business ventures. They walk in just as he's finishing cleaning up the leftover brain residue from earlier that night. And while they're there, they purchase tickets for Captain Spaulding's infamous murder ride. A haunted house, House of Horrors kind of scenario, as the group are pushed through a series of hallways in a cart, as Spaulding tells them stories of real-life gruesome murderers and their crimes. Eventually, they reach a killer named Dr. Satan, a local tale of a deranged surgeon who worked in a nearby insane asylum, and would experiment on the patients in a vicious and brutal manner in an attempt to turn the mentally ill into a race of unstoppable superhumans. He explains that eventually Dr. Satan would be apprehended and hung for his crimes, but the legend goes, the very next day, the locals would discover that the body had vanished, and that to this very day, there had been no signs of it ever showing up. Jerry, with a morbid curiosity, and being intrigued by this local gruesome tale, begins to repeatedly ask Spaulding for the location of the local tree that the doctor was hung from, eventually giving in to his request, and after telling him there's nothing good out there waiting for them, Spaulding draws him up a map and informs him on how to get there. While the group is on their way to go and stare at a tree, they notice and pick up an eccentric hitchhiker from the side of the road named Baby. She tells them that she lives near here and knows the area well, so she'll be able to take them to see the tree no problem. But while they're on their way, someone shoots out one of their tires from the bushes, causing the group to think that their tire has just popped. Baby tells them that her family lives nearby, and that her brother Rufus has a tow truck, and that Bill should accompany her back to the house to get him. We see that back at her house, her brother Otis is holding multiple cheerleaders captive, which we had learned earlier through a radio snippet that they had been reported missing, after going on some sort of insane and delusional tirade about freeing his mind and refusing to conform with society's expected standards. He does the completely sane and rational thing and starts to kill them. Bill makes the rookie mistake of entering the old creepy house of a strange hitchhiker who appears to have mutilated and decapitated dolls hanging from the walls. After some uncomfortable advances made by Baby, Rufus returns with the rest of the group. If Baby's bizarre behavior and the fact that us as the viewers know that Otis is currently upstairs murdering a bunch of teenage girls wasn't enough to persuade you that this family clearly is bad news, we then get introduced to the rest of them. The mother of them all, Miss Firefly, who is also as equally as strange as Baby, with her bizarre behavior and strong sexual advances, invites the group to stay for dinner while they all wait for their car to get fixed. Where they then meet Tiny, who is in fact quite literally the opposite of Tiny, Otis, who we've already met, who for some reason brings a jar containing a dead fetus to the dinner table, and the foul-mouthed, crude grandfather. They explain to the group that Halloween is an incredibly special time of year for them, and they plan on having a very special night indeed. They put on a show for their guests, consisting of the old man screaming vulgar things into a microphone and Baby performing a dance. Things seem to be going relatively well until Baby decides to get a little too intimate with Bill. Mary, his girlfriend, doesn't exactly take too kindly to this sort of behavior and pushes her off his lap while screaming all sorts of obscenities at her. They decide, after insulting this rather strange family and being told by Rufus that their car is now fixed, that it's probably in their best interest and well-being for them to get up and go right away. Just as things are looking like they'll be fine for this group as they're leaving, Otis and Tiny climb down from pretending to be Halloween decorations, incapacitate both of the men, and then subdue the women. They might have thought that they actually had a chance of getting away after Miss Firefly told them that it was probably time they left, but as soon as Otis and Tiny stepped into the picture, they had no chance of getting out of there. It's not even as if Mary having an argument with Baby was the main driving force behind them being captured. If that were the case, then why were Otis and Tiny lying in wait? The second they picked up Baby off the side of the road, their fates were sealed. They were never going to get away from this alive. Mary wakes up, restrained to a chair in a bedroom. Confused and scared, she begins to shout out for help, but all that that manages to accomplish is to annoy a particularly insane Otis, resulting in him threatening to cut out her insides and forcing her to eat her own intestines. And as you'd expect from someone being told that that would be their fate, she stops screaming out for help. Instead, she begins asking where her boyfriend Bill is and if she can please see him. Otis, being the fun-loving and friendly chap that he is, obliges and decides to let her see her boyfriend. The only problem being is that Bill has had his torso and hand removed, being replaced with what can only be described as some sort of giant fish creature skeleton, and he has now been renamed by Otis to Fish Boy. With the group originally intending to visit Denise's dad, when they inevitably don't arrive, the next day he informs his police friends about his worry and tells them that she mentioned she was at Captain Spaulding's gas station. So two police officers pay Spaulding a visit, where after some back and forth, he informs them that they were looking for the tree. We see Denise as she wakes up restrained to a bed, and Tiny enters the room and attempts to feed her. After she refuses to eat, she asks him multiple times to free her, and to her surprise, Tiny actually releases her restraints so she can get away. Obviously, things aren't about to be that easy. This is a campy horror movie after all. Just as she's exiting the room, Otis jumps out, grabs her and forces her into a cage, where she is then pounced on by a group of some sort of creatures. We then get to learn what lies in wait for Jerry, as we see him tied up in Baby's room, where she's tormenting him by cutting off his hair and forcing him to eat it. She decides that she wants to play with him some more, so she asks him what's her favorite movie star. obviously by knowing nothing about her and being quite frankly terrified for his life, of course he gets the answer wrong. Although, I doubt getting it right would have saved him anyway. His brutal punishment for answering wrong is to be scalped right there and then. In the typical insane murderous family trope, there's far more to these characters than just the kill. They clearly take great pleasure in the mental anguish and physical torture of their victims. They take pleasure in the act of inflicting suffering. After finding the missing group's car, with one of the dead local cheerleaders in the trunk, Denise's dad, Mr. Willis, an ex-cop, joins up with the local police officers in the effort to locate his daughter and her friends. They arrive at the Firefly's house, which of course only spells trouble for them, and after splitting up and heading around back, while one of them stays at the front to talk to Miss Firefly, Mr. Willis and the other officer decide to have a look around, and what they discover next shocks them both to the core. They open up the barn door to be greeted to the sight of dead and captive cheerleaders, all bloody and restrained. As they frantically radio the lone officer, upon realizing that the jig is up, Miss Firefly shoots him point blank through the neck, putting an end to her friendly facade that she was putting on. Mr. Willis is then shot through the chest by Otis, and the third and final officer is then forced onto his knees. After a drawn-out, long and tense wait, with the camera slowly panning away from the subjects, he is eventually executed on the spot without mercy. The surviving members of the group are forced into costumes and placed in the living room. And then, in a very Ed Gein-esque move, Otis wears the skin of Denise's deceased father and begins to torment her. The Firefly family then decide, because originally Jerry wanted to see Dr. Satan, being that the reason how they ended up in this horrific situation, they decide that they should show him what he wants to see. He's not just a legend, he's far more than that. He's real. The group are taken into a field and placed inside of a large coffin to be lowered into an underground cavern. But spotting an opportunity to escape, Mary takes off running into the nearby fields. She makes it to a makeshift graveyard, where she thinks she might have actually managed to escape from the murderous family. But before she can even catch her breath, she is tackled to the ground by a frenzied baby and repeatedly stabbed in the chest. The last two survivors, Jerry and Denise, are then lowered down. Without any warning, the coffin is torn apart by a group of ravenous humanoid creatures, and Jerry is pulled away. Denise then wanders alone through the cave, full to the brim with decomposing corpses lining the walls, until eventually discovering a room containing Dr. Satan's experiments, and the doctor himself mid-operation on his new plaything, Jerry. One of his experiments enters the room and begins in a pursuit after Denise while wielding an axe. After a couple of close calls, the creature accidentally takes out one of the support beams for the cave, causing it to collapse on top of him, crushing him to death while leaving an opening for Denise to escape through. Denise comes to, after receiving several blows to the head from the cave-in, she crawls out through the hole and is now finally freed from this hell. Dazed and in a state of shock, she wanders out onto the road, where she then sees a car approaching. This is it. After everything she's been through, having all of her friends savagely murdered, seeing her father's murderer wearing his skin like a Halloween costume, almost being a victim of the infamous Dr. Satan himself, she's now going to be able to get to safety. But when the car approaches, it's that creepy clown from earlier, Captain Spaulding. He picks her up, tells her he's going to get her to a doctor, and then she passes out. All of a sudden, Otis emerges from the back seat, giving her unconscious body a menacing and evil stare. Spaulding did say that he'd get her to a doctor, although he didn't specify that it would be Dr. Satan. There's no happy ending for House of a Thousand Corpses. Multiple times there was opportunities for these victims to get free, but any brief chance of respite was savagely and brutally ripped away from them. They were never going to get away from this. The Fireflies just wanted to have a bit of fun with them. Just like I stated near the beginning of the video, Rob Zombie is clearly a fan of classic fun and campy horror, and House of a Thousand Corpses wears that badge proudly. It's a fun, over-the-top romp fest of graphic and disturbing themes. It certainly doesn't quite live up to the expectations of it being so disgusting that it had to be shelved for multiple years. but it absolutely does the job and succeeds in what it sets out to do. The funny irony within the fact that Universal would ultimately end up burying this project is that 20-something years later, they'd end up creating two large attractions based around the movie at two of their theme parks. So the message to take away from this whole ordeal would be, if you want to make a movie about murderous backward hillbilly folk who wear the skin of their victims' fathers, then you go right ahead and make that. Make that dream a reality. This wouldn't be Rob's one and only foray into the world of horror movies. With his somewhat controversial Halloween movies, and House of a Thousand Corpses becoming a trilogy, there's plenty more to potentially look at in the future, and who knows, perhaps one day I might just do that. Before I wrap things up, I just wanted to say a big thank you to my patrons. Thank you to Dom, Bort, Hunters263, Caleb Barnaby, Victor N, Rebecca Pitts, Nicholas, Benz, and Jungle Dude. YouTube doesn't exactly take too kindly to this kind of content. Most of my videos end up getting copyright claimed or limited ads, meaning very little to no monetization. So it's incredibly inspiring that there's people out there who are willing to help financially support the channel as I try my hardest to make the best content I can for you guys. So once again, thank you so much to my patrons. Also, the channel has a Discord server, so if you'd like to discuss this movie, or other movies in general, with like-minded people, there is now a place that you can go and do that. Also, if you wanted to leave me a movie recommendation for the channel, that would be the best place to go ahead and do it. So once again, thank you so much to my patrons, and thank you to everyone else for watching.